The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Well, thank you for joining us on this third Sunday in Epiphany. We're halfway through Epiphany and halfway before Lent begins, if you can imagine, early in February. Thank you so much for joining us. We're glad to have you here today. A reminder, immediately following worship today, we're going to have a Zoom meeting to answer questions, to talk about our upcoming annual meeting. Our moderator, Terry Anderson, will be on hand, along with Dwight Miller, our treasurer, and I'm going to be available also, so we can talk about our plans for, or how we're going to make plans for reopening in 2021, and what we're doing with worship, and how we're going to plan and face the year together with hope. So do join us as you're able. And then next Sunday, on the 31st, our worship service will be concluded by 9:30, and we will have our annual meeting. There's going to be information coming about that this coming week. The annual report has been sent by USPS to people who receive information by mail from us. You likely received it already. It went out on Wednesday. And to everyone else who receives things electronically, we sent it out by email, so you should have received it. If you haven't, please call the office at the number you're going to see here, or send an email, and we'll certainly make sure that you have it. So then, let us begin by joining our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. O God, you are our light and our salvation. Living in your presence, we have nothing to fear. Open our hearts to your word this day. As we hear the story of the call of the first disciples, make us ready to follow Jesus on whatever path he leads us. Cast aside our fears and doubts, and teach us to trust wholly in you. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
My God is mine.
With no reason to pretend and in no position to judge, let us confess our sin before God, neighbor. Let us pray. Loving God, we confess that we have turned from your way to follow our own ways. Forgive us the times we have spoken or acted too quickly. We have not spoken or acted at all. We have hurt those closest to us. We have hurt those we have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than we ought. We have thought less of ourselves than we should. Turn us around and give us a fresh start so that we can live again as your children. Amen. Amen. Friends, even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we are broken apart, God holds us together. God's love never runs out. God never tires of calling us beloved children. So hear now what God says to us all. Our sins are forgiven. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ to be with you always. Peace, Christina. Peace, David. Now turn to Scripture with prayer of illumination. Let us pray. Almighty God, in you are hidden all treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Open our eyes that we may see the wonders of your word, and give us grace that we may clearly understand and freely choose the way of your wisdom, revealed to us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from Jonah. Listen for the word of God. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up and go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now, Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God, and they proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed God's mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. Words of life. Amen. Now a responsive reading of the psalm, Psalm 62. For God alone my soul waits in silence, for my hope is from him.
He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken.
On God rests my deliverance and my honor. My rock, my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him.
God is a refuge for us.
Those of low estate are but a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion.
In the balances they go up. They are together lighter than a breath.
Put no confidence in extortion.
And set no vain hopes on robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart upon them.
Once God has spoken, twice have I heard this.
That power belongs to God, and steadfast love belongs to you, O Lord.
For you repay to all according to their work. Amen.
Thank you.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark. Listen for the word of God. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boats, mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Words of life. Let us pray. In a minute. There are many times I wish all of this was easier. When I wish my role was to soothe and comfort and celebrate only. But we believe the truth sets us free. Faith equips us to thrive through challenges we neither want nor welcome. Yet faith in God makes a way for us where we could not make a way by believing in ourselves or having faith in our own power. Surely living in this pandemic is helping us to understand our faith in new ways. Surely social unrest and domestic terrorism presents unwelcome challenges to our faith, leading us to ask, where is God in all of this? And in all of this, how does God call us to respond as people of faith? These challenges are like Jonah's whale, swallowing us up as we run away from God's call in our lives, only to find ourselves belched up on the seashore of our own Ninevehs, answering God's call despite our efforts to flee, which, after all, is a story we find again and again in Scripture. So, friends, let us discern together what the disturbing and challenging of call of God is on our lives, what it means for us in this time and in this place. So now, let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts this day be pleasing in your sight, O Lord our God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. Few writers capture the paradox of God's call on us like the Trappist monk Thomas Merton, who says, "Like Jonah himself, I find myself traveling toward my destiny in the belly of a paradox." In what seems self-contradictory and absurd lies a deeper reality and a more meaningful truth. In answering call, Merton says, we discover our true selves, moving away from the false selves that emerge as we try to protect ourselves from people or social pressures or shames or disease. The experience of opening ourselves to the call of God in our lives and moving away from the known into the unknown most often comes as a response to personal crises we suffer, to traumas we experience alone, together. Merton's understanding of call is hard won. His experience of depression was the belly of the whale for him. The paradox he names an experience common to us all. When we run away from God, or when we find ourselves swallowed up by darknesses, we find ourselves instead being carried toward God, though we do not know it at the time. And later we look back and tell the story with wonder and gratitude. I often find myself struggling against the notion that the call of God is only about pastors. But this understanding of call is not what God intends for communities of believers. For we are all required to answer the call of God on our lives, to employ our gifts, to give our time to the glory of God, whether we are mechanical engineers or county workers or accountants or music teachers. We are called and we are responsible to struggle with the paradox of call. It is neither sufficient nor faithful to say, I don't have time, or I am too busy, or I don't want to get involved in conflicts. For the call of God is given to all of us, and it is not equal to all the other demands on our time in our lives. The paradox is that we all have more time and more life and more of everything important and lasting when we ourselves and as individuals, as a congregation, accept our own responsibility to answer the call of God on our lives. In 1956, Richard Niebuhr wrote a paper called The Purpose of the Church and Its Ministry. 1956, Ike was president. 1956, the South was still segregated. Way back then, there were 4 TV networks, and families had 1 phone number. Imagine. The Korean War had ended, and we were getting involved in Vietnam. In 1956, we had yet to witness the assassination of a president and a civil rights leader. Back then, Watergate was just a building in Washington, D.C. And in 1956, churches began adding on to their buildings for the post-war boom of children and families who were coming back to church. In fact, our church undertook a building project shortly after this time. In 1956, and for years afterward, the church as an institution was flush with resources. Women who had not yet entered the workplace gave their time and energy to the church. Serving on councils and boards was a high honor. There were no traveling youth teams playing sports on Sundays, and that was completely unheard of. Businesses, in fact, were enclosed on Sundays so owners and their employees could attend worship services at the church they belonged to. In short, the church was at the center of American life and culture. And here lies the paradox. The world was changing, and the institutional church was called by God to change with it through social upheavals, the rise of the civil rights movement, the liberation of women. But the institutional church most often did not find the call of God in these challenges, but rather saw the changing world as a threat to itself and a danger. The paradox of the call of God back then and today is that God prepares us for and calls us into these challenging times at the very time voices are raised up saying that we should hold fast to what we already know and stand firm to what we already love. Though to hold fast and to stand firm on what we have known in the past often prevents us from answering the call of God in our lives in the world today. Take, for example, the 2 sets of brothers in our gospel lesson today, Peter and Andrew, James and John, who are mending their nets, preparing to go fishing. They are there on the seashore, doubtless a short walk from their own home and hearth, from the boats that they have built or inherited, and the means by which they feed their families and earn a living for themselves. James and John are, in fact, working with their father. And Jesus comes along and calls them away from all of this and into the unknown. James and John abandon their father. Imagine. Peter, we know, has a mother-in-law. And therefore, he has a family of his own, we know. And he leaves them behind when Jesus says to him and his brother Andrew, "Follow me." We cannot faithfully answer the call of God now or ever without leaving behind people and things we know and love, ways of understanding ourselves and others that have made sense in the past but no longer do, ways we structure our time and organize our lives and work. Answering the call of God and moving forward necessarily means leaving behind what we have known and love and what has held meaning for us in the past, but which becomes a burden and a weight holding us back and limiting our ability to share the love of God with the least fortunate among us for whom Christ died. Were I a psychologist, I would offer a schema to help us see how trauma and difficulty we are living through may lead us to respond in fear and turn inward and project our anxieties on others, demanding the world and everyone else change to match our longing for a time that is no more. But as a faith leader, I have another message of hope to offer. It's this paradox. Within this suffering and within this challenge, inside of whatever hardship we may face, God is present and calling us forward, nudging us to leave behind past things that hold us back, coaxing us into a future that will transcend everything that we have known or could dream of. This paradox of call is not easy, though. I can't make it easy for us. When we say yes to call, when we step forward into the unknown, we discover our truest selves and the false selves we put on for others, the ways we pretend so as to protect false unity, the way we hold back what we can give because we are worried of how others will judge us. All of these things we are called to leave behind, and it's not an easy thing to do. But when we leave it behind and follow Christ into the world, then we find our true selves, who God calls us to be, who in faith we are becoming together. God calls us away from relationships that force us to sacrifice our true selves. God calls us to leave behind habits that hurt us and those we love. God calls us into new power to love with life-giving integrity, making room for new life to emerge in us and others. For this is the structure of the paradox of call, the structure of the paradox of faith, the structure of the life we live. If there were no paradox, if faith were solely about comfort, then faith would be altogether unnecessary, really. And we could merely follow traditions of the past and serve our own comfort and known things and tend our families and make time for God when it's convenient and easy and agreeable. But as we are more aware now than ever, life is challenging. Loving people is hard, and when they are struggling and we can't tell how much to help them, it's really, really hard. The world is changing in ways that leaves us wondering how we will manage in the days ahead, which is precisely when we become ready to answer the call of God on our lives. Yes, I know what I'm saying, Does it make sense in the sense that it's paradoxical? It makes no sense except by faith. To accept what I'm saying means admitting to a level of human vulnerability that we're not really comfortable with, that's terrifying. But in these challenging times, in the world, in our homes, at work, in church, God is calling us to follow Jesus Christ, to leave behind what limits and burdens us, and to move forward in faith to what will not merely make a way for us, but a time when we will thrive and be renewed through God, who will provide hope for us and through us, healing for us and through us, reconciliation for us and through us, into a broken and hurting world which we know we're living in. So, as we seek by faith to enter the paradox of God's call in our lives in these times, may God bless you and your family, and may God bless Windsor UCC. Amen. Thank you, Dave and Christine. That's one of my favorites. Let us pray. Hear our prayers, O Lord, and send us your Spirit that we might learn how to pray. We remember again that you called neither the wise nor the wealthy to be your disciples, but rather those with willing hearts, ready to leave behind a life they had known and step into the unknown. Remembering that your church was not built on their willing faithfulness, that we are here millennia later because they answered your call with willing hearts. We hear these stories and imagine simpler times, quite unlike our modern world filled with pandemic and social unrest. We follow our own routines in answer to the demands of bosses and creditors and families. This idea that you call us and that we answer with our lives seems yet another demand among many. And so we pray that you would help us to order our lives, O God, with enough quiet to hear your repeated, persistent call to meaningful and purposeful lives, filled not merely with getting and spending, not with hurling from one event or appointment or game or meeting to the next, but finding in each moment, in each movement and interaction of our lives that we are following you, that you are at work in the world through and in us, in and through our faithfulness, in and through our attention to your Spirit. Lead us out of our comfortable numbness and divert us from mindless routines. Inspire us to employ the gifts we have been given, including our time and passion, to following your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for people who are desperate for change in their lives, for a second chance to go in the right direction, who would gladly leave behind relationships and habits and behaviors that entrap and stultify them. Through their willingness, raise them up and lead them toward truth and peace and heal their souls so they do not turn back but follow you. And as we pray for this congregation and for our people, both those who gather in worship and also the networks of families that extend from us, we pray for us as we seek to answer your call to discipleship. Help us to choose what must be left behind and to trust that you will multiply our gifts and skills, our contributions of time and money and attentiveness, our worship and ministry in ways that glorify you and bring meaning to our lives. We pray for those we love and those with whom we struggle, and for those times they are the same. Hold us with tenderness. Grant us strength to endure and faith to thrive. Give us courage, resilience, and decisiveness. And fill us with your Spirit no matter where we might travel. Reveal your vision to us that we might see ourselves and others as your own beloved children. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Friends, our nets are full enough already with God's good bounty. Our hearts are open wide to the needs of others. So let us reach out and share what God has given us. Let us pray. Bless our gifts, O Lord, and transform them into gifts of love for your beloved people in the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, friends, may God bless and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Well, on behalf of our office manager, Barb Varner, I'm Craig Jan McMahon.
David Schipper.
Christina Metzger.
Have a great week. We love you. Bye.
Have a great week.